Complain, complain, complain. That's what the Israelites are doing here as they leave Egypt. They hated being slaves, but at least they know what was going to happen to them. In our world, it's a little like going from a corporate job where you work 60 hours a week like a slave, with only 2 weeks off when you're working the phone and the laptop the whole time, and then suddenly being kicked out into the gig economy, where everyone is freelance. And you can get work, yes, because you undercut the price that they would pay for a staff position. But the staff position includes rent and health insurance and benefits and sick leave, all the stuff the company doesn't have to pay for if they can make you pay for it, because you are freelance. And you never know where the next gig is coming from. Suddenly, the old world of slavery looks pretty reliable. Miserable, yes, but reliable. Verse 3, the Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, because you, Moses, have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Now things are so up in the air, they are wishing the Lord had sent the Egyptian army fast enough to catch up with them, kill them with the sword, and with battle horses and chariots with scythes on the wheels, slicing and dicing them. Their fear is so powerful, it outweighs their fear of death. They would rather die than face uncertainty. Which is what freedom is. Fear of the unknown future is a powerful thing. People respond to fear. And the thing that they think will save them is to go back to what they were familiar with. What is unpredictable in this story is how God is going to come in and make something happen. That's something no one can count on. They think they are going to starve, and they think they will die of thirst. So Yahweh comes in, the great I am that I am, enters into history. God enters their world. Let's look at the elements here. How do historians look at the desperate need for food and water? For water, we see in a later story and today's psalm, God has Moses strike a rock with his staff. The rock breaks and water pours out. This is the same staff Moses used to turn the Nile blood red. It is a means of revealing God's power. Plus, I love the image of Moses surrounded by worrying and doubting priests and elders, and he smacks the rock with his stick. With a staff. Boom! And the water pours out. It's like a spring or a creek coming out of the ground in Minnesota. I've seen springs come out of the ground. So I know that that's not impossible. Then the quail. Well, we know what quails are. Who can tell us that the quail covered the camp or not? So that's not impossible. And as they say out in Wilmer, them's good eating. Now, manna is central to what we do here today. The usual translation for manna is, what is it? Because the Israelites did not know what to make of this stuff. But there are other ways to translate the word. One explanation goes like this, quote, man is possibly a cognate with the Arabic term man, meaning plant lice, with mannu, thus meaning this is plant lice, which fits one widespread modern identification of manna as the crystallized honeydew of certain scale insects. In the environment of a desert, such honeydew rapidly dries due to the evaporation of its water content, becoming a sticky solid and later turning into whitish, yellowish, or brownish. Honeydew of this form is considered a delicacy in the Middle East, and it is a good source of carbohydrates. In particular, there is a scale insect that feeds on tamarisk, the tamarisk manna scale, which is often considered to be the prime candidate for biblical manna, end quote. So a honeydew carbohydrate that comes from plant lice, the way that honey comes from bees. That's a jarring realization, if you've never heard it, but that's what matters here. So if there is such a thing as crystallized honeydew, that is a delicacy found from a type of plant lice, and all they need is enough of it, that's not impossible either. I'm pretty sure I've talked about the crossing of the Red Sea, as it is called, but let's go over it again. Let's review. First, the Red Sea is a mistranslation by early scholars because they had heard of that sea, but they had not heard of the Reed Sea, which is farther up the Nile Delta. In the land of Goshen, the eastern part of the Delta, where the Israelites lived, the Reed Sea is a swampy area that has only a few places where you can cross. Otherwise, your chariot's wheels will get stuck. Your feet will get stuck in the mud. The horses will get stuck. Well, it has a stable westward wind that blows east, which keeps the water at bay, kind of like holding back a storm surge. And the wind is pretty steady. But sometimes the wind dies off. When it does, water comes pouring back in. So it is not impossible that the Israelites cross this familiar territory with the wind up, and then the wind dies down when the pursuing Egyptians come through. The water doesn't actually have to drown them. But if it stops them in the mud, then the Israelites get away. And the tale grows with the telling. People like to exaggerate. So crossing the Reed Sea is not impossible. There are other studies in archaeology that say that while there is an element of truth in many stories of the Hebrew Bible, there also seems to be a lot of exaggeration. For example, the great battles where it seems like Joshua is slaughtering tens of thousands of the inhabitants of Canaan. Well, there is no physical evidence for that. And there's plenty of evidence for other battles from the same time period. They think that the authors of the Bible, of those Bible stories, are trying to create a heroic past for the people to be inspired by. Kind of like the United States, bragging up our part in World War II. The United States lost about 400,000 killed in the war in all the battles combined, plus 3 civilians. That's a lot about the population of Minneapolis. The Russians? They could lose 1 million in one battle. The Russians lost a total of 9 to 14 million dead military and 15 million dead civilians, 24 to 29 million people. That's more than all of Texas. When we see that the Russians lost about 70 people for every one that we lost, we might want to go examine what effort we put in to that war by comparison. So exaggeration is part of our world as well. The Israelite scholars probably exaggerated those battles, and they also probably exaggerated the number of Israelites crossing the desert. Modern Jewish scholars doubt the biblical record. According to Numbers 146, the Israelite army stood at, quote, 603,550, end quote. An army of that size, just men, would project a support in tribal population of 2.4 million. Rabbi Michael Leo Samuel notes this: no ancient people in antiquity ever amassed an army of that size, with the possible exception of China, end quote. A large Middle Eastern army of that time might be as many as 40,000. Not 600,000. So let's assume a much smaller band of people crossing. Let us also salt in a piece of archaeology still under dispute, coming from the Sinai. there is evidence of a tribe of slaves who escaped from Egypt called the Hebiru. So there is ample fodder to construct the possibility of a smallish tribe making their escape across the desert, feeding on a local delicacy for carbs in a good year for quail, with a guy who has a good divining rod for water. That's not impossible. Now, let us set aside the historical record and those possibilities and ponder on the metaphorical truth of what is being laid out here. Because facts are never as important as meaning. The Manna Society described here trusts that God will provide. They gather their daily food. Bigger families gather more, smaller families gather less. Everyone has enough. On Friday, there's twice as much, so that Saturday can be a day of rest, the Shabbat. A day of rest for the people, for the animals. Everyone gets a day off. Not like today. Now we work longer hours than the slaves and the beasts did 3,000 years ago. But in this story, God provides enough, and the people learn that. If they try to gather more than what they need, it grows worms and it stinks. We don't need more than we need. This coincides with what archaeology tells us about the Israelite habitat in Palestine once they get there. These are small communities, towns of several hundred, and the houses are all about the same size depending upon the size of the family. Bigger families have bigger houses, smaller families have smaller houses. There are no big houses and no slave quarters, like there are everywhere else in the Middle East. It is an egalitarian style community, a manna society, where everyone gets what they need, no one hoards, no one goes without. No grand palaces, no slave quarters. Those come in pairs, palaces and slaves. Slave quarters. Israel was an economic democracy. It's a great example of what historian Michael Parenti says, the rich are the great cause of poverty. This is not about an individual wealthy people per se. It's about a system that creates wealth while denying subsistence to those who do the work. Wealth of the pharaohs can only come about with acres of slaves. The wealth of Rome is created by a population that was between 40% and 60% slaves. The Israelites, however, were unlike most everyone else in the world. They had a society that treated people equally. Their system worked under the judges. But once King David was secure in his kingdom, he built a palace for himself and a palace for the priests. The people were treated more and more as subjects and less as citizens. The palace and the temple grew wealthy and the people grew poor. The manna society that crossed the desert had no wealth system. Everyone got what they needed. No one had more than they needed. They had enough of an abundance to take a day off every week. The Sabbath, the Shabbat. Remember the Shabbat to keep it holy and to keep you holy, because you are a child of God. Your life is sacred. Your life is made of your time, and therefore your time is sacred. And God wants you to spend one day a week resting, caring for yourself, spending your time in restorative measures. You can't do that when you're a slave in Egypt. And that abundance was shared equally among the Israelites. In Egypt, You may have had enough to eat every day, but the fruit of your labor trickled up, not down. And honeybees die from working without rest. We should not be as busy as bees. Let us now shift to this parable of Jesus. The last shall be first and the first last. What is Jesus talking about here? It seems like the guy running the work site is just trying to burn the people who got there first and worked all day. Why should they get the same pay as the new guys, the people who show up towards the end of the day when the heat is off and the work is almost complete and the sun's going down? What Jesus is looking at are his followers, who started with him early on trying to claim some sort of privilege over any of the newcomers, the late arrivals. Who will sit at your right hand, Jesus, and who will sit at your left? I was here first, say some. But the supervisor says, look, what I paid you is what we agreed on. I'm not going back on my word. Why should you resent me for what others get? What's it to you if I'm generous? Of course, Jesus is not talking about money. He's talking about the love of God. That the first in get exactly what the last in get, and that no one is being cheated out of anything. In fact, the spiritual nourishment that we get from knowing him and loving him should have clued those guys in to this intention of generosity of spirit long before. It is odd then that those who have had the longest time with Jesus can somehow resent the fact that Jesus loves the newly minted followers as much as he loves them. Again, the disciples are often looking to have a higher rank among themselves, among each other. That's the system they're used to. Who is his favorite disciple? Who has been here the longest? Don't I get special treatment? I was following the band back in the early days, back in Galilee. I should get some VIP passes. But Jesus says, don't you get it? This love is not ranked. This love is not about tenure. It is about equality. Love is not a pie. If God loves this person, that does not mean there is less pie for you. If God gives you a piece of the love pie, that does not mean there is less pie for everyone else. God does not run out of the love pie. What I saw yesterday at our festival was this congregation at its best, handing out the love pie to everybody. You are welcome, says this congregation. Here's some free music. Here are some cool booths full of things and ideas, manned by interesting people. Homemade bakery goodies, piles of cheap stuff, hundreds of cheap books, new office chairs, Boy Scout bratwurst. We are handing out the love pie. The community is built on handing it out. God's love is not about scarcity either. It is about abundance. It is not going to be saved by hoarding it, keeping it to just us. Hoarding love means it grows worms and it stinks. Love grows by giving it away. And it seems like something people can resent it, or sometimes people can resent it when it is given away to the newcomers. God's love for each of us is infinite. And there is no infinity greater than another infinity. Do we love a child who is 10 years old more than we love a child who is newly born? No. They are different shapes of infinity, but our love for each is infinite. God loves us equally because love is infinite. There is enough for everybody, for those who got it early on, and for those who are only getting it now. Let us pray. Dear God, who has shown us the pleasures of generosity, help us to be generous in our hearts, to freely give to others the love that you have given to us. All this we ask in your name. Amen.